proud and happy to be part of this journey with Ogli, with Anjali and Kamal. And this group that we have today in this virtual room, this is a brilliant set of young leaders. I've had a fantastic last 1 month just interacting with them. I think I have, and I say that after most workshops, I've picked up a lot more than I've given. Just quickly taking you through what was the format and what we focused on. We started with talking about communication skills, why communication is important. And we also spoke about, because a lot of stage fear, glossophobia is a word in the English language, and it means fear of public speaking. And according to a survey conducted, 85% of the people globally, for them, number one fear is not death. Number one fear is public speaking, being on stage and talking in front of a bunch of people. So it's important that anxiety and the fear for public speaking gets addressed now when children are still young. And so that's what was the foundation of the first two sessions of this workshop. When we moved on to my favorite, which is my absolute favorite, is creative thinking. And I think which Anjali was referring to as thinking magically. And I think the leaders here will agree with me. That was the most fun we had, where we understood what basically means thinking out of the box. What is the box? And what is creative thinking? Why is it even important? Why this whole buzz around creative thinking? What is its needs? And my biggest invitation to the group was that since creative thinking is a problem solving methodology and a tool, my invitation to you guys, I told them, was that start using creative thinking for your day-to-day problems and issues in life. And that's your practice ground. At the same time, parallelly, start thinking in your communities, what's the problem that your community is facing? Your neighborhood, your school, are there too many stray dogs? So we were talking very real, and I gave them some actual tools, because the way the brain is wired, we end up thinking, if we have to go from A to B, we think in very linear terms. And creative thinking is about breaking that linear way of thinking and thinking totally tangential. And that's where innovation and new ideas are born. So that was the second week. And the third week, we focused again on from creative, now moving on to critical thinking. And what's the difference? Again, why are these buzzwords all around them? And why are people talking creative thinking? What is the difference? That is what we sort of dealt with. And we went on to do some more work on presentation skills. We are on week four now, and the leaders, Anjali always corrects me. The leaders have been given certain projects which they've worked on. So they've got just about week 10 days of time to work on their projects, and they've done a lot of brainstorming, creative thinking, critical thinking. Basically, they've used all the skills that have been taught. We've tried to make this as real and close to real life as possible, and not like a big gyan session. In fact, there were so many things that I had not even, this group is so, they're so sharp. There were so many things that they sort of got out of me during these 4 weeks. I never planned that I'm going to be talking to them about kinesthetic and auditory learners and visual learners, but they got it out of me. So we've had an absolutely fantastic time collaborating, interacting, and just getting the best from each other. I think I'm going to hand it over to you, Anjali, to and then we can start the sessions for the three teams on their projects.
So really, I mean, to organize this demo day has also stretched us a lot more because the children came in, the leaders came in with such a varied interest between biotechnology to aerospace to sustainability. But that's exactly where you are sort of always learning from each other. So it was equally exciting for all of us as well. So let me just start with the first panelist that we have. Because we wanted to make sure the panelists also feel the pressure of the preparation that the children have put through. So with that, I welcome Sanjay. Sanjay is a dear friend and an expert on media, OTT, e-com space, having 29 years of experience in sales, marketing, and strategy across telecom, financial services, FMCG, consumer goods. Apart from media, he's a prolific speaker and see many CMO forums. You should look him up because a lot of ads are to his credit. So I'm sure he'll bring his magic on as he speaks to you. Currently, he's also looking at leading Amps Prime or Cellebite. It's a very interesting app. And in fact, he mentioned to me today, Sanjay, so congratulations on that. They've made it to the top 23 engagement platforms in the world, Global VC List. So Cellebite has got that to their credit today morning. So with that, Sanjay, thank you so much for joining us today to lead the group, and we could get a wave from you here. And with him, we are also joined by Bhagyashree. Bhagyashree Prakash Dharmadhakkari is an analyst with Optra. Optra is also a Stanford-led company, and it is essentially in data-driven intelligence focused on improving outcomes for consumers and life sciences. So this is where we were challenged, Bhagyashree, and thank you so much for taking out the time to join and mentor the group because your company itself is known to use AI very innovatively to solve for some of the challenges that we have in the medical sciences. So specifically, Bhagyashree has also been involved in scientific data curation domain, mainly aiding in therapeutics and advances in healthcare. So thank you so much for joining in, Bhagyashree. And a quick wave from you. And we also have now our equally competent team one coming in. I think my escape button is giving me challenges today, but we have got a team one who's come in today. And I would love to sort of invite them to also come in and present. And let me just hand over the segment to them. But they are looking at a project that will be demonstrating designing a monitoring system to gauge the current public healthcare and country state. So with the team one, we have Alicia, we've got Parth who've come in, we've got Rifa. Let me just see if I can just share the team and the effort that they've put in putting the presentation together. Yes, there we are. So we've got Alicia over here, we've got Parth coming in from Presidium, we've got Rifa, we've got Suhani. Suhani is also struggling a bit with COVID, I am aware of that. She might not be joining us today, and we've got Tanin. They are completely ready to take you through their nanotech project. So I will hand it over to them. And post that session, Sanjay and Bhagyashree, I will just request you to please give feedback as well as share your suggestions with the group. So over to you, team one.
Ma'am, do we have the right for sharing our screen?
Yes, Rifa, you do.
Yeah, Alicia, please share your screen. Okay. A very good morning to everyone present here. We team one, the Young Bucks, are going to present our interesting project about planning a monitoring system to gauge current state of public health in Delhi. Our team includes myself, Rifa, Alisha, Tanay, Parth, and Suhani. Unfortunately, our member Suhani, she's down with COVID, so she won't be able to join.
Yeah.
I would like my teammate Tanay to continue.
So we wanted to start the project by highlighting the importance of the project, which is that in India, we get to know the problems after they get really worsened. And so our app will help to predict the problem in our state in its initial stages. So we will be able to tackle the problem before it gets worsened and cause death. So there are too many problems in our healthcare system, but our team has pointed out the main three problems. The first one is that lack of authentic information, and the second one is unavailability of urgent medical supplies, and the third one is services.
Now moving on to solutions, we have come up with our own app named as Savior Care. We are in partnership with the Delhi government. Now, we like to start everything with an interesting point. So whenever you open our app, you'll be asked three questions. How are you feeling today? And what are you looking for? Moving on, there's one problem in every app. Whenever you download an app and try to sign up, they'll ask you tons of questions. Your name, your phone number, your address, your email address, verification code, and what else. But we have come up with a unique idea. We'll instead ask our users to enter their Aadhaar card number so that we'll get a complete information about them, about where they live, if they are Indian citizens or not. Now, many of them will be worried that why to share our Aadhaar card number, because that's, you know, a private information and no one would like to share it very easily. But as I've said earlier, we are in paid partnership with the Delhi government. So there's no problem with that. And our users can trust us.
So I'm Tanay. So we wanted to get transparent with our users, related to the terms and services and the privacy policies. So before starting the app, our app will show this app permissions, and it will ask you if you want to give the following app permissions so that there will be no problem. We have basically divided the Delhi into 20 main parts as shown in the map. So it will be easy to analyze the information, and it will be easy for the government to tackle the problem as soon as possible.
Now moving on, data collection. Every person will ask one question. Is your data from a reliable source, or is your data even reliable? Our answer is yes. Our first idea is Google Trends. Now come on, who doesn't trust Google? The whole world depends on Google. So first option we had is Google Trends. We'll collect our data from Google Trends. Our second option is medical stores. Now, as we are in paid partnership with the Delhi government, we'll have a tie-up with every medical store in Delhi. We'll provide them with a government authorization certificate that this data is being used for right work and they don't have to worry about their data being leaked. We'll collect this data on a weekly basis and analyze it according to the medicines, which medicines has been used the most, like that. And on the third option is doctors. We'll contact doctors that do not get many patients, who are nearly unemployed. And we won't take just any doctors. We'll have an interview if they are to see if they are qualified well enough or if they have much experience, because we don't want our users to go in wrong hands. So we'll obviously have an interview and then we'll choose a doctor. So whenever if you come to know, okay, after we get the medical analysis, weekly analysis, and we come to know, okay, for example, in Chandni Chowk, we are having a rise in prostin, Dole 650 and a cough medicine. So our app will send us notification in our server saying that we are having doctors, you can consult a doctor. So it's a natural human tendency that these users will consult our doctors. After the consultation, we'll send our doctors, a Google form where they just have to fill, hardly three three things. That is their name, where do they reside, and what was their reason for consulting you. So obviously, after getting many forms, we can analyze it. From Google Trends, we'll find out, okay, these questions were asked the most. From medical stores, we'll analyze about the medicines. And from the doctor's consultation, we'll analyze what sickness. And after analyzing these three aspects, we can tell the government, okay, this is the sickness which is being spread in this particular region. So before it accelerates, the government can take proper action. So this is our total data base, which you can understand. Moving on, my teammate Alicia will continue.
Okay, now comes our criteria of work. We are working with the model of exchange, which means the doctors will get patients and in return provide us with the information as mentioned above. Same goes with the medical stores in accordance with the information that we'll get from them. Now comes keeping in check the availability of urgent medical help. We have teamed up with the AIIMS, Delhi, and government hospitals to track the availability of hospital beds, ambulances, and ventilators in case of any emergency. Moreover, this data will be updated on the app every 12 hours. Now comes the availability of vaccines for all diseases. We have decided to include in our app a very important and unique feature, booking vaccination slots for all the diseases, especially for the newborn babies. Moreover, we will have a constant check on the availability of oxygen cylinders and other medical supplies. We have a connections with the dealers providing oxygen cylinders and ventilators and other medical supplies all over Delhi. This data also will be updated on the app every 15 hours so that the users do not panic at the peak hour.
Health updates. So our app will also have a feature which is health information. As we all know, the basic problem that we face today is a lack of authorized information. As we mentioned before, even if the data is available before, whenever we search our symptoms, many deadly diseases comes like if you search for coughing, like you are coughing and you go and search in Google, it will show very deadly diseases that you might be having this. So it will put a lot of mental pressure in the patient. So our app will have a feature on where a patient could search his symptoms and also could search the disease directly. And the information will be provided by authorized sources, and it will be provided by certified doctors in manner, and all our information will be provided in a very minimal way, in a very friendly manner to avoid an inconvenience. Helpline numbers. Another main problem that we face today is the lack of availability of helpline numbers. So our app will access our information and will provide all the necessary numbers, like the numbers of the hospitals which are present around you, the numbers of ambulances that are there, and the numbers of medical supply agencies. As you can see in the image, it is basically a map where the intensity of any disease will be available in a very simple, understanding way, and the app will send you a notification whenever you cross a red or an orange zone, which depicts a very high rate of disease or virus in that area. You will also be able to access our map through the app.
Now we come down to our sources of income. We expect most of our income coming from the commissions by the medical stores and the doctor's appointments booked from our app. About 3% from the doctors who get patients from our app, and about 7% from the medical stores that get orders from our app. Moreover, as we previously mentioned, that this app will be in partnership with the Delhi government. This way, we will be acquiring about 5% share from the vaccination slots booked from our app. Furthermore, we will be acquiring about 20% of commission from the dealers selling urgent medical supplies on our app. Now we come down to our cash outflow regulars. The first and the foremost expenditure is salaries. We expect about 60% of our revenue to drain out by distributing salaries. Then we expect advertisements to drain about 20% of our revenue, which includes running social media promotions, newspaper ads, and sending out pamphlets. And then around 10% to be drained out with the management of our server database.
Expansion goals. As we all say, plans are nothing, planning is everything. I will be sharing with you our interesting expansion plans. So we are planning to include NGOs and donations as one of our app features, where our users can help the NGOs in certain ways, which in turn will also help us in our advertising. For example, if an NGO is hosting a campaign in Changni Chowk, they would have to hold banners saying sponsored by Savior Care if our users have helped them. In turn, the help of our users will also not go in vain, as we will offer them points. These will be awarded to them whenever our users help the NGOs purchase medicines, donate, book doctor appointments and vaccine slots, etc. through our apps. These points can then be redeemed for getting discounts in medicines, as in doctor's appointments, vaccine slots, etc. It will also help us in cooperating social responsibility and goodwill in our app. For further expansion, we are planning on joining hands with companies such as Apple, Samsung, Vivo, etc., which will help our app grow in the market. Whenever these companies launch their new update, our app will also be included in that update. These plans will not only help our app expand its user base, but also help provide social service to society. Now my teammate Reefa would like to conclude our presentation.
And Reefa, you have 30 seconds. Okay, you are nearly done.
Yeah. Reefa, just I would like to say a famous saying of Winston Churchill. This is not the end. This is not even the beginning of the end. But it is perhaps the end of the beginning. You know, I feel a very unusual sensation. I don't know if it's nervousness, but I feel it's gratitude. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone. Appreciate your patience.
Perfect. Thank you, team. You can stop sharing. Sanjay and Bhagyashree, over to you for questions that you may have for the team.
Bhagyashree, you can go first.
Okay. The presentation is very well. I like it very much. The idea is also very nice. But the thing is, I just want to ask about the data, whatever they are going to take regarding to healthcare and all. So how much they are sure about its specificity, accuracy, and relevancy? And is it updated information? And what sources they will use for this?
Ma'am, yes, it's we'll obviously take it from reliable sources. And as we mentioned, we'll use Google Trends, medical stores and doctors, and we'll have this analysis weekly, so that we don't if we do it monthly, for example, if we do it monthly, we'll have our analysis at the end of the month. So for example, if I have an analysis of July end, okay, and in August, I don't know if there's a breakdown in Chandni Chowk of viral or flu, anything. So obviously, I have to wait till the end of the month for the analysis to come. Until that time, the situation will accelerate, and we don't know how much a virus or flu and how many people have been dead. So that's why we are keeping it for weekly timings, weekly analysis, so that we don't harm the people by waiting for monthly.
Okay. Nice. And what will be the success rate of this app? Have you tested this?
Ma'am, we haven't actually worked in that depth. We actually haven't got much time on working in that depth. So I won't be able to answer your question.
Okay. Fine. Good. I like this. Nice.
Reefa, I got a couple of questions. First, I found your scope is very, very broad. You want to do too many things and, at the same time. Can you just tell me your problem statement, what you're trying to solve in one line? What is the key purpose which why you are doing this app?
First of all, sir, as you know, India is not at a good rank in health department. It's actually at the lowest. So we are at least trying, you know, the government cannot do, we youth can do. We have that potential. We can make a difference. So, for example, in this COVID-19, you are seeing the death toll is increasing rapidly. So at least we young leaders can, you know, at least make a difference of 5% in reducing the death toll by whatever means we can help in, through this app. And if we were giving more time, I'm sure we would have come up with many, many great features and helped it out.
No, Ripa. See, that's why I asked the question, what is your core objective of this thing? If your core objective is to reduce death rate in Delhi for whatever purpose, okay, it can be COVID, it can be any other disease, like, okay. So who is the right recipient? So what has happened, you know, you have merged multiple things. Like, you know, you started almost on the wrong end. If I take your problem statement, so what you are trying to do is the government wants to improve.
Excuse me,
they don't have that. Similarly, people who want to access healthcare system, they don't have the proper information. So rather than going and starting from the sides, like, you know, give your personal information, which I see no relevance, why your app will collect my Aadhaar card and my personal details, which is absolutely no relevance. You should start with, like, you know, I think Bhagyasri asked you a relevant question. How will you collect data? So data are always like kept in silos, you know. It is not easy for you to find out. If it would have been so easy, the Delhi government would have been publishing, you know, so many hospital beds are there, so many patients are doing this. So hospital, like medicine supply in the hospital is like this. You know, like medicine stores all can be, how the medicine store you'll collect data. There has to be API system. Everybody need to fill up the system. You have to have a backend system to do that. So you want to put too many things into it. And why should a person will download your app? What you need to really look at is narrow your vision initially. First objective is, what is the core problem you would like to solve? For that, your app, people will keep that app. So you know, you don't have enough money for you to really go and, you know, ensure everyone to keep the app. If Delhi government does it, and, you know, only 5% people or less than 1% people download this app, Delhi government will not be satisfied with this initiative. I think the first problem to solve is, like, you know, government has a healthcare system. People are not able to avail it. Can I really make it transparent? I'm just giving an example. That is one way. Or if you want to reduce the death rate, death is at the end point of it. Okay, why the death happened? Because people don't get the medical care on the timely manner. How can you improve the timely manner of supplies? For example, it is not about COVID prevention. You know, it is about, if somebody is detected with COVID, can we really give the oxygen at the key point kind of thing? So I will focus on that point. Rather than, you know, creating a system for, you know, your vaccination, you can actually take vaccination over here. So you have tried to get into everything. You want to be a pharmacy, one MG, you know, all these things together, which will not really going to happen. Practopharm plus pharmacy plus one MG kind of thing, you cannot happen. What you need to, I think you identified the situation well, but when you go in solutioning, you added too many things to it.
Yes, I got it. Thank you for your feedback. I understood what we were trying to explain. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Sanjay, Bhagyasri, any other questions? Otherwise, I think we've got a good, you know, feedback from both of you. If the panel has no questions, I do want to summarize this. And this is a classic mistake of an entrepreneur, Ifa. So all of us who have built businesses have tried to do it all to realize that I think a solution is well-defined when it is very well-scoped.
So, yeah, so I want to add then.
Ma'am, we learned from our mistakes.
Yes.
Yeah. Also, maybe in the next group, we should add a few sessions on entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
Because scoping and creating a sharp problem statement isn't something that we held the group's hand for. And I think the problem itself that was given to them was slightly very large.
Yeah.
So maybe we can work next time a little bit on entrepreneurship.
Yeah. Good job, team. So kudos on that one. So let's move ahead. I would love to sort of now introduce our next set of panel coming in, which is our panel two. And with that, I would love to sort of introduce to you Prashant Singh, who is the founder and CEO of MJoy. And Prashant has also built a business along with us when we started out 3 years back. So Prashant, hi. We know him from that time. Prashant is the founder of MJoy. It's a prop tech startup building, renting, iRenting for residential real estate. He's a computer grad from DCE, having 10 plus years of experience across finance and startup. Now, what is very special about MJoy is the fact that it's on a mission to make property ownership a hassle-free affair. And this is completely first tech-enabled full-cycle rental, which is what is unique about it. You will realize that it is, again, looking at disrupting this whole market of rentals, which is so, I would say, non-tech, very relationship-based. So that's where their foray is. And obviously, they are winning many awards in that space. So Prashant, thank you so much for coming on board for our second group presentations. We also joined with Shinjoy. And Shinjoy, I had to call upon. Thank you, Shinjoy, for joining in. I had to call him upon because we had a lot of young leaders with legal as an expertise area or interest area. So thank you for joining in. I've known him for having 20 years of experience across data protection, IP litigation, prosecution, IT and cyber laws. I think what is very unique about him is, again, he's also using one of the first techno legal advisory and consulting in this space since 2018 and has trained more than 100 plus professionals on it. I think also which is very unique is that he's also been training the cyber cells across the NCR region on cyber laws, IP Act. And so he's always got very interesting stories on what's the latest which is happening across the frauds in that space. So thank you for joining us. He's also a regular speaker, so you can look him up. Very interesting stuff. With that, I also want to introduce the group that is going to present to you, the group B, which I would say also is equally demanding, dear panelists. So please be aware as they present to you IoT-based system to monitor carbon emissions from an industrial plant. This is being led by and led across Angad, Kapil, Saidaksh, and Snehil. So with that, I will hand it over to this able group of enthusiastic children. Over to you, group two. Please take it away. So you can start presenting.
Good evening to everyone present here. Good evening to everyone present here. Our team consists of myself, that is Sai, and along with me, I have Angad, Snehil, and Kapil. We have designed an IoT-based system to monitor carbon emissions from industrial plants and display the collected data on our website called Carbon O-Meter. Without further ado, let's dive straight into our presentation. Before explaining anything else, we would like to talk about the problem we have chosen to solve, that is monitoring and reducing carbon emissions.
One of the biggest problems this planet is facing is climate change. This cannot be ignored, and the world is undertaking numerous measures to prevent and control this. Increase in the gases affect the following. Increase Earth's average temperature, influence the patterns and the amounts of precipitation, raise sea level, etc.
Carbon emissions are defined as the total amount of carbon dioxide, methane, and carbon monoxide emissions. It is also expressed as carbon dioxide equivalent or carbon footprint. There are three scopes of carbon emissions, as you can see on your screen right now. As you can see in the next slide, this is a graph for methane emissions that have been continuously rising since 1985. And the pie chart on the right shows the contribution of various gases to carbon emissions. Now, we are going to explain what is the issue with carbon emission monitoring and calculation.
Many organizations and companies are already engaged in carbon monitoring and industry consultation for reducing emissions. Our carbon monitoring competitors are NASA CMS, NASA OCO2, India's NTPC, etc.
All of these organizations and companies have some drawbacks, though. For example, NTPC provides detailed annual reports for each plant, but it is inefficient as it is not according to real time. Moreover, the data which is accessible to the public by NTPS is for government-owned thermal plants and not for privately owned plants.
And for carbon footprint consultancy services, there is SCS, RPS Group, and more.
We solve this problem by providing services that our competitors do not. For example, we provide free access of detailed real-time carbon emission data to the public in an OTT service. We also provide consultation to the industries and residential buildings who purchase our packages, telling them how they can reduce their carbon emissions. We also target small privately owned industries, and most importantly, we provide a combination of all services that our competitors provide separately or do not provide at all.
So now talking about one of our most important parts of the project, how it's going to work is using IoT. So IoT stands for Internet of Things and is very widely used across the world. It refers to connecting objects around us to the internet using sensors. So for buildings interaction, we use sensors like gas sensors, sound sensor, touch sensor, etc. And the general process that IoT follows is this, where a sensor observes its surroundings, an action follows, and then the data is displayed on a website or an app. And IoT is a very growing industry, and its revenue is expected to grow to more than $1 trillion by 2030. Another important part of our project is integrating OTT services, like mentioned before. So OTT or over-the-top integration is any streaming service that delivers content over the internet. And these days, users can sign up for OTT services and access their offerings through any internet-connected device, such as computers, mobiles, gaming consoles, etc.
Carbon calculators are used to calculate greenhouse gas emissions of facilities in order to determine the amount of greenhouse gas produced for a specified year. The results can be used to prepare plans for actions to reduce the amount of greenhouse gas emitted. They take in several inputs like power consumption, water consumption, thermal discharge system, etc. of the factory, and return the carbon emissions. The emissions per unit of electricity are in range of 0.91 to 0.95 kilowatt for carbon dioxide, 6.94 to 7.20 kilowatt for sulfur dioxide, and 4.22 to 4.38 kilowatt for nitrous oxide.
So what we do? We have a startup with some solutions, and I want to explain the startup in three phases. Phase one, we will find factories and set up carbon emission monitors there. It's actually NDIR sensors or ADC sensors, which will transfer the data to our web hosting space. In phase two, we will have some carbon emission knowledge or calculation of carbon emissions and setup of appropriate sensors. In phase three, the data with JSON encryption from a web hosting space to the website will be displayed, so there's no manipulation over the data. And so everyone can access it for free of cost. So the process is explained here in a flowchart, like finding a factory, visiting and consultation, identifying carbon emission locations, installing emission sensors, and etc.
Well, they mentioned that we will be, and a fundamental part of the project, we will be finding some factories. So the industrial plants that we are targeting across India are Vindhyachal, Mundra, Tirota, Talcher, and Rihan. And these are across India, like in states like Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, etc. And we have chosen these plants on the basis of how big they are, how much capacity of power production they have, and whether they have any carbon controlling systems like Tirota. So we will provide a good comparison to the viewers on our website. And to show our website, I am going to present a high-level design of our website to give you a brief of our UI UX design. So I'll be presenting the carbon calculator page. So this is how our website should look. We have carbon emission meter, which is the place where the data from the factory will be shown. This is a check whether the air around the user is pure or not after asking the user's location. This is AQI, carbon calculator and packages. This is how the search bar works. And then if you scroll down, we see that there are three calculators for factories, houses, and residential buildings. So for instance, if we click on the factory calculator, it asks us several questions, like for example, the demographics, the energy consumption, chimneys, combustion of fossil fuels, thermal discharge systems, carbon capture, etc. And after filling all this information, when calculator is pressed, this page should show up with several graphs, basically a pictorial representation. So what we're planning is basically thermometer graphs and spirometer graphs to show what category of what category, like whether good, satisfactory or bad, does the factory fall in. And the most important part is that our website will also show ways to improve.
So how we will earn from the startup? So there are basically 5 steps through which we can earn. The first is carbon credit. It's actually credit given to company to, this is a permit through which how much carbon emission they can do. Like one carbon credit is equal to amount $10 and it's equal to 1 ton of carbon dioxide. Like there's 2 companies who have given 1 crore carbon credit and one company uses 99 lakh credits and one company uses 1 crore 1 lakh credit. So the company which is using 1 crore 1 lakh has to buy 1 lakh credit. So what we will do, we will tell companies that we will save your carbon credit and when you sell it, we will take some share. The second step is CSIR. Okay, it's a regulatory body which has said that, okay, you have to spend some money to consume the carbon you have emitted. Like it's a fun trivia that most number of mangoes in the market is by Adani and most number of apples is by Adani. Why this is? Because they have to plant trees to stop the carbon emission. So what we will do, we will say that if you buy a subscription or fund in us, it's actually a way to fund in CSIR. So you will save your taxes. The third step is about consultation, which will be explained later. Fourth step is about paid webinars, in which we will have paid webinars and we will earn from it. And the fifth step is advertisement on our website.
Now let's talk about a few solutions which we would give to the factory if they take up our packages. So there are several solutions which we can suggest. Like for example, there can be low energy burners used, ESP, HCFC systems, carbon captures, etc.
So let me tell you what we have done so far. We have contacted a few industry experts for the approval of our plan of action. We have also designed a few pages of our website as shown before. With some external help, we will be able to expand our idea further. Due to the pandemic situation, we were not able to physically meet anyone and thus we could not click any pictures. So that is why we presented some screenshots of our website. Now, moving on to the final section of our presentation. Here, we will be telling you all about our future plans and how we hope to expand our system.
Expanding the system to every household by trying the level best to communicate with as many residential buildings, RWAs, as possible.
We will provide extensive and detailed reports and consultation services to companies that wish to strictly monitor and decrease the carbon emissions from their factories.
We will keep improving our user interface and UI UX design on the website with more visual representation and slightly more detailed reports. With time, as when there is improved technology, we will accordingly improve our sensors efficiency and accuracy. We will also reach out smaller private industrial plants to help them monitor their emissions as they might not have established such system on their own in the factory.
The audience here can contribute to our mission in several ways. You can persuade your localities, RWAs, to take up our packages for efficient carbon emission monitoring. Moreover, we urge you to repeatedly use our carbon calculator so you can keep track of how many emissions might be coming from your house. Studies have shown that about 350 kilograms of carbon dioxide are produced annually in every Indian urban household. These emissions come from your air conditioners, microwaves, whenever you heat something in the kitchen or when you travel in your car or through chimneys and etc. And now, as our presentation comes to an end, we would like to thank all of you for giving us this opportunity to present our idea about a very serious problem that will only become worse in the future if we do not start making changes now. Thank you for listening to us so patiently. We would also like to thank our mentors from Augley for guiding us and helping us through this process. All 4 of us have put in a lot of work in these past 10 days, and I'm very proud of each one of us. Thank you. We would now like to answer any questions or doubts you have regarding our presentation.
Excellent job done. Lovely transitions, lovely handoffs, panels. Over to you, Shrinjoy.
Yeah.
And Prashant.
Yeah. Thanks. Prashant, you want to go first?
Prashant, you're on mute. Right?
Shrinjoy, you can start.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks, Prashant. So panelists, one of the first things that I was just looking at while I was listening to your presentation is exactly how is it working in the sense that is it only going to be on the website, or do you have plans to have some sort of app or some sort of hardware that is there?
What we will do, we will go to factories and find out the carbon emission points, like the points where carbon emission is happening, like chimneys and other places. Then what we will do, we will install sensors, like basically NDIR sensor or ADC sensor here. The sensor will then transfer the whole data to our hosting space.
Yeah, yes, can you explain that, please? When you are explaining it, perhaps you can, when you're saying NDR and you are giving these acronyms, maybe your viewers or your audience may not know all of what you are saying. So you'll have to explain it a bit better. Yeah, go ahead, please.
NDR sensor is basically an IR sensor which transfers infrared rays. And when it rays passes through, it bounces back. And when it bounces back, it captures the particles in between, which will capture the amount of, okay, methane is there, carbon dioxide is there, or carbon monoxide is there. Similarly, ADC sensor, analog data to character data transfer system, it will transfer the same data to our websites, the web hosting space with JSON encryption. The encryption is for, so we cannot manipulate the data. Okay, some company gives us money. Okay, don't show our data that we are emitting too much. We will not disturb the data. From that hosting space, it will be shown to our website and in the future development to our app, so that people can easily open our website or an app and easily access through the data without any manipulation, with the pure and line to line per second knowledge. Like every second the emission may be changing, so they will having every second emissions.
Yeah, and this is basically, then what I understand it is how it's working is, this is basically a hardware device that is in the factory area.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fantastic. And the problem is basically the carbon emissions from these factories.
The monitoring is not done properly. Like in large scale industrial plants and factories, the government has established some guidelines that you need to monitor your emissions. But for small scale industrial plants or privately owned plants, for energy or any other use, they do not have any proper system in place. And even if they do, they try manipulating the data so that they do not violate the government guidelines in that sense. So we look into solving that problem by providing real data from the factory.
Okay. When you're saying IoT devices, from an IoT perspective, you have taken care of the hacking considerations that are there? You have taken care of the security and encryption?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Data?
Yes, JSON encryption.
JSON encryption will do it?
Of course.
Okay.
But so yeah, we are in a future development, as we have explained in our future plans, that we will be trying to change it through also, but currently it's JSON encryption only.
Okay.
So I have a question. So why do you think that a company like, let's just say you touch upon NTPC or probably a Maruti. So have you heard of the Volkswagen scandal?
No,
sir. I'll give you some context. What happened is, you know, between 2009 and 16, Volkswagen, which is, a very large automaker. So they were deliberately cheating on emission norms. So they were eventually fined close to, I would say, 200 million euros. So all those industrial standards and, you know, checks and balances were there, but they were deliberately cheating. The reason behind this is, you know, pretty simple. It's because of, profits and all. So my question being, you know, why would a company like NTPC, you know, would integrate with a third party, which would be you, a private agency, to sort of monitor their data, and what financial incentive is for them to do that?
So
the government.
Yes. Sir.
Yeah. Can you say?
So we offer different features, which I think Snail can explain now.
Yes, sir. It's a very nice question. Okay, what we will do is, actually we will also consult them. Like if they're emitting more amount of carbon, we will consult them. Okay, if you do this, like if you plant oak trees, or if you shut down your machine for 1 hour at this time, then you will gradually lower your emissions And as the term carbon credit, which they are saving, they may save them also. And after that, they can sell it and earn money also. So the company will be in profit by taking our subscriptions also.
So, adding to his points, as you mentioned that Volkswagen was charged a very high amount. So, sir, if industrial plants like these come to us and take a consultation, then this money would not be lost as fines. Instead, they would make profits by saying the carbon credits, as Snail mentioned.
So, they would basically be investing in themselves by paying us.
No, I understand your point that you touch upon that eventually every company wants to have a 10-15 year, you know, roadmap to be carbon neutral, and you know, all the big companies, even if you've heard about the Reliance, this AGM that happened, so they are very bullish about, you know, going green. So these all are buzzwords. I completely understand. In terms of what I sense is, you know, when you're looking at a problem of this scale, you know, industrial IoT is a $1 trillion industry that's going to happen unravel in the next decade or so. You know, we have to look at it from a first principle approach. So maybe, you know, you can Google it, what is the first principle approach. So all these, you know, solutions that are there right now, but then we have to think about what the actual problem is. So we have been given a framework to sort of, you know, assess how your pitch went. So in terms of identifying, you know, opportunity, and I completely agree, it's a $1 trillion market. You know, in terms of the idea that you have conceived, I think, you know, you have to be a little more creative about understanding the situation, what is happening. And in terms of, you know, how feasible this is to implement, I sincerely think that, you know, there is still a slim scope of, you have to think it in terms of how, you know, how easily this can be implemented. And in terms of scalability, you know, once you are able to implement it, so this being a tech solution, this could easily be scaled. In terms of presentation communication, I would say excellent. But I would still ask you to go back to the drawing board and think about, you know, you've identified the problem, but then, you know, you have to drill down the problem to absolute basics, what actually the problem is, and then you have to think of something creative. Like if you read about Elon Musk, he wanted to start this, you know, he wanted to go to space. He didn't go to Boeing and said that, you know, design aircraft for me. Aircraft for, you know, rockets were costing around $65 million. He is charging $6.5 million and still making a profit out of it. So he started designing, you know, rockets. So this is what we call first principle approach. So, you know, you have to be a little creative in terms of the solution that you offer.
I agree.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
The whole dynamics, I think, is this, that the question as to why should any industry subscribe to this at all is in question, number one. Number two, even have you got the numbers of the fine versus what you are going to give them for carbon credits, as carbon credits? So
yes, sir, actually the one carbon credit is around $10, but it changes, like shares, it changes.
But in terms of, in you're trying to balance the fines, you were just now talking about balancing the fines to the carbon credit. So actually
it's like that with our consultancy law. Like if a company is emitting like 1,000 ton of carbon in a month, then we know that, okay, in 10 months, they will emit 10,000 ton, which is exceeding the limit. So as their consultation, they would avoid, they will tell them, okay, you can do this measures, you can do this measures to stop that limit. And yes, CSIR says that, okay, if you are emitting this much, you have to spend this much to control your carbon emissions. As I have told you about plantation is done and other things. So what we will say in company, okay, if you buy our subscription also, it also comes under CSIR regulation that, yeah, if you're investing in us, it will be also considered as, okay, you are investing in stopping carbon emission.
Yeah, I think when you are going back to them and when you're trying to provide this to your potential customers, such as NTPC and others, you will have to be more number driven. They will have to see something tangible. Just you saying it might not really have weight with them. They'll have to see something tangible. So why should I if I am also in NTPC's shoes, why should I do it? Why should I look at it? Unless you are telling me, yes, I am going to benefit from it. It's all profit. Unfortunately, it's all profit. If I see a profit in investing in your system, then I will come forward or not.
Yes, sir, your point is very much important. And yeah, we have noted it and we will look at it in the future. And yeah, that feedback was very important for us and we will do more extensive research on this. Thank you, sir.
This discussion and the maturity and the depth of discussion was a great reflection on your team too. I think for you to be able to hold the panelists' attention and engage is completely a reflection of the hard work that you put in. So you do tempt me to think about Peter Thiel and the concept of zero to one. Completely the biggest leaps that happen in progress are vertical, not necessarily horizontal. So you've really taken on that idea as a group. We've given them the flexibility to think and really hit the ball out of the park. I'm quite impressed. And I can tell you, Shinjoy and Prashant, they might just come back to you because you've given great feedback, because this is a project I would love to see to fruition. So kudos on that, and thank you, Shinjoy, and Shahan, for good engagement.
Thank you.
Lovely. So let's move ahead. Last is never the least. We have the third panel, and with that, I would love to sort of introduce to you Swati Talwar and Shantanu Gupta. Sorry, my Skype is not working, so I'll just leave it on half present mode. Swati Talwar is a senior director with InSpirit. InSpirit is an extremely interesting 3D STEM iOS app. It is trying to make life sciences fun for children. And we, in collaboration with InSpirit, incidentally just finished a debate championship across 11 countries. So thank you so much, Swati, for partnering with that. But Swati is even more interesting. With 13 plus years of experience across research, project management, content marketing, she's worked across, you can talk about many industries, from Gartner to MakeMyTrip to Amazon. She's herself a cross-section of art and technology, loves watching interesting TV series, is a Zumba instructor and a dog lover and a CrossFitter. Swati, wow, how do you pack so much in? So thank you so much for joining us today. With that, thank you for the wave. We've got Shantanu Gupta with us in an interesting space and an interesting logo, which he feels very proud to be associated with. He's with Airbus and he's based in Munich, in the headquarters of Airbus Defence and Space Division. It is salivating to hear that. So I'm sure he's also very proud, having worked for 2 decades across aerospace technology and manufacturing, lived across US, UAE and Germany. He's an expert known beyond his engineering roles. When he's not really working, as he says, he's either long distance running, hiking, playing the guitar and being a control freak to his twin daughters. And Shantanu, I can assure you that the moment the tweens turns into teens, it becomes tough, and you'll get that sense today from our group as you mentor them. So thank you so much for joining us, Shantanu, and mentoring some of our folks. But the teams over here, the panel three, or rather the team three, all got us excited to reach out to you. So thank you so much for joining us, Shantanu. We've got team three, which is looking at designing advanced satellite solutions for monitoring human trafficking. That is rather interesting. It is a team combining of Pranav, Ishan, Apurva, and Laksh. They have put their minds and thoughts together. So with that, I will hand it over to team three to take this away. Over to you guys.
Yeah. So, hi everyone. Good evening. We'd like to introduce you to Orpheus, a personalized and global attempt in designing an advanced satellite to monitor human trafficking. This will be the flow of our presentation. And now, starting with the problem, human trafficking. On this slide, you can see the definition of what human trafficking means and how it involves the transportation, coercion, and exploitation of victims. But the problem is not knowing what human trafficking means. I'm sure that almost everyone here would know what human trafficking basically constitutes. But what most people don't know is the scale of human trafficking and how big it really is. So let me ask you, how profitable do you think human trafficking as an industry really is?
$1 billion?
It's actually $150 billion. And that's only in profits, making it the third most profitable industry in the whole world. And these profits are only increasing, and the problem is only getting worse. Despite attention, the number of victims have tripled in 10 years. Now that we know how big the problem really is, it's time for some statistics. Human trafficking has affected 40 million victims worldwide. In fact, if you randomly selected 1,000 people in the whole world, you'd find at least 5 victims of forced labor, forced marriage, and sexual exploitation, all through human trafficking. It's shocking how this issue is mostly polarized towards women, with 71% victims being female. It's also extremely gruesome to also know how over 10 million or 25% of human trafficking victims constitute of people under 18. And from the target demographic for prostitutions and forced labor and other illegal activities. Now, human trafficking has become an issue of extreme importance for organizations like UN and ILO. However, this is all it has been reduced to. Even though the issue gains international attention and more governments allocate resources to combat it, these efforts are to no avail. It's also shameful to know how there is no country or region that is immune to human trafficking. In fact, the victims of human trafficking belong to 145 nationalities. Both the handlers and the victims of human trafficking are found in almost every country. On this slide, as you can see, 4 dominant forms of human trafficking include labor and sexual exploitation, domestic servitude, and forced marriage. A human trafficking victim is likely to experience all these forms and most of the time in the exact same order. But when we talk about human trafficking, people only think about sexual exploitation and don't even know what forced marriages, domestic service, and labor exploitation are all empowered through human trafficking. And as we earlier talked about children, from one of the most prominent demographic and are exploited for children soldiers and child pornography. Poverty-stricken parents also may sell their children in order to pay off debts. In fact, just a decade ago, children were sold in the states of Odisha and Rajasthan for less than 3 rupees. On this slide, you can see the 3 stages of trafficking. The first one is movement and recruitment. The second one is coercion, and the third one is exploitation. But out of these, the most dangerous of steps is movement and recruitment. Movement and recruitment consists of a lot of people and has dangerous means of moving people from one country to another. Not only that, but it's extremely profitable. As human trafficking is a crime of hidden nature, there is a limited data on how it functions and also limited means to control it. There are also no laws restricting this type of movement in countries like Egypt, Iran, and Saudi Arabia, which makes the lowly punishment of measly fines often worth the crime.
And now we come to our technology. So Marcus Aurelius once said that, "Look to the skies if you're ever stuck, and you'll surely find your answer as I found mine." And so we literally did. And I'd like to introduce you to the Astraeus X, our own satellite. This is the Astraeus 1, our first model. But in 1 week, we went from this to the Astraeus X, which includes, for the major part, pretty boilerplate equipment for a nanosat, like a relay chip, electric circuits, solar plates, rechargeable batteries. But the most important part here is the Hearth 7. The Astraeus X, made with revolutionary CubeSat tech and hybrid miniaturization, has the most advanced cameras on the market. And the Hearth 7 is a 4-tier customizable module and forms the CPU of our Astraeus module. The first module is our satellite framework, as you can see here. and gives us a 40% higher payload, does away with redundant side panels, and enables high scalability and helps us to license the Earth 7 to existing satellites, which would enable us to scale faster. The second and perhaps the most important one is the infrared camera, which senses midwave and infrared radiation and helps us to detect temperature signatures in isolated locations and zoom without sacrificing resolution. Like you'll see here, on the left, you have a satellite image. And what our camera does is, through a low water stress generation, provides this image, then goes through a heat map generation to provide this image. The images are taken from various angles and are stacked with each other to increase the resolution and remove the reflected radiation. So while Google Maps may be able to give you this kind of a heat map, our tech can easily distinguish between buildings, sea, and land. The third and fourth module of the Earth are pretty standard. An on-orbit processor cuts down delay in identification by reducing latency. And the fourth is a relay communicator device, which uses simplex transmitter and GlobalStar low orbit satellite network. And the data is sent to the ground within seconds from anywhere in orbit. But the question is, how does this technology give us our solution? Well, through thermal imaging and machine learning. But first, let me ask you. 73% of human trafficking happens through sea. And since our organization believes in that to tackle any sort of challenge, we need to dig at the roots instead of hacking at the leaves. And hence, we created a specific solution for this 73% through our streamlined process. First, machine learning filters used by human trafficking networks are understood. Then, thermal signatures in these isolated hotspots are tracked. As these heat signatures pass through machine language filters on the basis of threat assessment and number of filters passed, these are labeled as potential human trafficking networks. In the early stages, data is analyzed to optimize the algorithm and create a trusted database. The data is then encrypted with advanced encryption standard 256 and then shared with the subscribed consumer base. But how is the machine learning going to work? Well, after the launch of our satellite, for the first 90 days, the satellite will be on machine learning mode, or MLM. During these 90 days, the satellite learns frequency of ships in hotspots, route patterns that create the automated build module. The data of priority case studies will also be fed to the satellite to optimize the algorithm. After all this, it results in the machine learning parameters for labeling someone and determining ML filters. So these are the routes our satellite would focus on. So here are some in the central, in Northern Africa and Europe. This is a quite notable human trafficking route, and also in Southeast Asia. So they'll be learning frequency of ships and priority case studies to determine ML filters. However, filters might include standard routes in the range of invisibility, making a conscious effort not to come into radars of federal ships that are tracked through our satellite, the size to passenger ratio, and continuous stops in this range of invisibility. So if a suspicious ship or heat signature checks through these certain number of requirements listed by the machine learning, it is labeled as a potential trafficking risk. The information is sent down, analyzed for verification, something that will be redundant as the algorithm gains experience, and the data is then provided to the subscribed authorities. So now, market strategy and competition.
Yeah, next slide, please. So our market strategy heavily relies on our product excellence and data analysis. Our competitors also have expensive models and poor data models, and some haven't even broken even in the past decade. Next, please. Next slide. Yeah. This map tells us where the best locations for thermal imaging in the satellite worker are. The ideal locations include some of the most trafficking prone areas like the American-Mexican border, Southeast Asia, South America, and some parts of the Middle East. Unsuitable locations are usually included in the dry regions of the world that make it a little difficult for the thermal imaging camera to distinguish between the thermal signatures. So the most important question that all of you must be asking us, why us? Why would you choose our team's theorized satellite over other satellites? Well, with our state-of-the-art thermal imaging module that offers data in midwave and long-wave infrared range, the answer becomes very easy. The data is automatically processed and after a couple of runs, goes straight from space to the computer. With our future expansion plans, every spot on Earth can be observed by satellite constellations and maintaining coverage of the areas that matter the most. Next. Okay. And the answer becomes almost obvious with our route forecasting and prediction algorithms that could even predict future trafficking routes even before the trafficking networks even figure them out. Something that is extremely unique to our company is our interface. It's also going to be customizable and customers can set their own parameters and be notified for the events that they feel are significant. With our field of technology, we realize that new applications will come up with the data analysis and thermal imaging, and we hope to expand into providing data for disaster response and management, flash drought warnings, and vegetation water stress. It might not look like it, but our satellites are extremely cost-effective, and its exterior can be made with earlier Cold War era satellites too, and can be launched through rideshare missions. So this graph clearly shows how our company works. So we aim at providing give better performance at lower cost as compared to NASA, who require large amounts of budget for giving results. So our first expansion includes the futuristic and ambitious Cygnus. It's our attempt to create a constellation of nanosatellites so that each trafficking hotspot is closely monitored. Our service is able to receive data from a variety of existing satellites, but by developing our own CubeSat constellation, we will be able to speed up detection time significantly. We plan to break even only after the first couple of CubeSat launch and increase profits with the launch of every single one after that. This will increase revisits and help detect trafficking more closely. Its specifications are 600 kilometer sun synchronous orbits launched on ad hoc rideshare missions, as well as dedicated launches. So our two-pronged approach also includes, as we mentioned earlier, licensing. We can license our HERT-7 modules to other satellite companies who can use this module in their satellites, as the HERT is a dynamic and adaptable module. It can be fitted into orbit satellites with very little to no change. It helps to cut down cost and helps us to be sustainable.
So here are some challenges that we identified. What about trafficking on land? We realized that trafficking on land, though it is less than trafficking on sea, forms an extremely widespread part of trafficking. And due to obvious temperature similarities, the thermal imager may not be able to differentiate between heat signatures on hot, dry land. And so we hope to implement new solutions in these regions too, and hope to partner up with apps like Red Light Traffic, which allow citizens to report suspicious activity that may be related to human trafficking and help us monitor even the minimal data. This is our team, and that's it. Thank you guys for listening so patiently, and we'd like to thank our mentors from Oakley.
So we welcome any questions that you guys may have for us.
Yeah, you can stop presenting. Perfect. So panelists, over to you, Swati and Shantanu.
Yeah, Shantanu, would you like to go first?
Shantanu, you're mute.
Yeah, if I only had a penny for how many times in the last 1 year we heard the words, "You're on mute." Can you see my screen? All right. I could start with, maybe I have different questions for the three speakers. Maybe let's hit it like that so that we give everybody a chance to explain their piece. Apoorva, first I'd like to go with you.
Yeah.
I like the data, how you frame the problem. It's a very noble problem. Two questions. what were the sources that you consulted to compile the data? And let me finish my questions. And because this problem is probably not static, it moves every year. So which year's data were we seeing and from which sources? And the second question, how did you consider other methods of solving human trafficking as a problem before arriving at the satellite solution?
So for the first question, I actually didn't, made this part of the PPT. And like it was my teammate Pranav who made this part. I don't think so. I have an answer for that. But the second one, I guess, I think it was from 2014 ILO, International Labor Organization.
I agree.
So, yeah.
Maybe
we
would like to pick that up.
Yeah, maybe, but that's the point we try to make over here is perhaps we, if you're in 2021, our 2014 data, the most reliable, could we maybe think of having more recent data? That's the point I would like to perhaps make. So the data is good to have a data as the sound, as the basis of the problem is very good. But did you guys consider other solutions to human trafficking before arriving, or did Pranav say, okay, I want to build a satellite, so let's find a problem for it?
Yeah. I think Shantanu, Pranav's laptop has hung. He's just messaged me. And this group was given this problem statement.
I think I'm back.
Oh, you are back.
Yes.
Okay, sure.
I'm sorry. I couldn't hear anything for like a minute.
Okay, so there were two questions Shantanu asked from your team, from Apurva. Number one, the problem statement was defined well, but where did you get the data from? And from which year? Also, did you look at any other solutions before arriving at this one of building a satellite, or was it that you're in love with building satellites? So you
The data is from 2014 ILO, but the thing is, since human trafficking is it's quite of hidden nature, you really don't know most of about it, and the most money that United Nations and the ILO contribute towards it goes mostly in surveys and monitoring and change in population demographics. There isn't any real work in monitoring where are they coming from, and they only just identify transit countries. So there isn't a lot of data after 2014 that really monitors profits and how big is this industry. So yeah, those are the last trusted figures we could find. Otherwise it was just, you know, hearsay from non-reliable sources. And well, we were provided this designing a satellite for human trafficking. And I'm not in love with providing extremely high expensive solutions for problems, but space is probably a good place to start.
Okay, so I don't know, Swati, if you wanna. But because he touched the topic of funding, so that was anyway my next question is, what is the funding you need, young man, for such a thing?
Since we're doing this on rideshare missions, so like a company like this would have been grounded a decade ago if it would have started, because space exploration wasn't cheap then. And now with these Starlink missions especially.
What do you think should be the funding?
300,000 euros.
Really?
Yeah.
And what will that include?
Most of it will go towards development of the satellite and to SpaceX for the ad hoc rideshare. And we really want to partner up with SpaceX for Starlink for the Cygnus mission that we our constellation of nanosats.
Is there any other company that is doing precisely this right now?
Yes, there is. In fact,
There's Loft Orbital, the company that...
perhaps a company called Planet is doing this. That problem is being solved by Planet for the last 5 or 6 years. Suggest you look at how they went about doing this. They had very similar. So it's good that you researched. So on your bit on the presentation, I don't know how much Swati caught, but if I was a lay listener, I would like some of the jargon to be demystified. It was a bit too much, perhaps even for me coming from the industry. I was comfortable, but it might bamboozle other people. Funding is very important. And then when you're already aware of other companies, then perhaps put them on the map. So I like that map that Ishan showed. Mm. But then I would like to see many more companies. Lots of startups are doing this.
Yeah. Thanks, Shantanu. It's always good to have someone else go first, because I'm pretty sure it's like 60% of the questions that I had he's already asked. So first I'm just going to set the context, like the third team, which is Orpheus. Like, thank you so much for being so creative and being so brave in even answering all the questions. And this goes across for all students here, leaders, not students. And it's very interesting, and I know I'm digressing, but today marks the day 24 years ago that J.K. Rowling actually wrote or published the first book of Harry Potter. So I think we're very aligned in what the kind of magic that I'm already seeing with all the leaders here. So I want to focus on the good things that I liked about the presentation first, and then I'll ask some questions. Most of them have already been answered and asked by Shantanu. So I actually liked, amongst all the presentations, the fact that Team Orpheus had a table of contents or a low structuring of how the presentation is going to go. It helps the person absorbs large amounts of jargon data better. So that's a great job done. Good that you had a table of content. There is data definitely that you're giving. And I think that's because I come from a consulting background where we are absolutely taught to give the latest data possible. So all of the data questions that Shantanu already asked, and always footnote your presentations or your slides on what the source is. You can put it towards the end as well, but it's just easy for conversation. So somebody asks you, like, is this the 2014 data? Is this dated? Is this recent? So then, you know, you have something which is already there for people to look at. It's just good practice to have data on the slide that you're talking about. I liked that, you know, towards the end, you guys were also talking about what are the alternate usage of the satellites, you know, from human trafficking, what are the other things? And the topic itself is super heavy. So it was interesting how you guys wanted to break it down. But I understand that, you know, you've already been given a hypothesis. You've been sort of given a solution. This is how we're going to tackle it. And that's where you built it on. But I think if I were in your place, what I would do a little differently is try and understand the problem set a lot better. This was a very linear approach where things like would countries sign up for this? What are the challenges that can happen? You know, if you have something where space as a territory is being explored, what are some of the challenges that can come up? I think there were a lot of assumptions that countries will sign up, UN will sign up for these things. And also a little bit more reading with respect to examples of companies. So while you guys were talking, and since I knew that, you know, this was the topic that you guys were going to speak about, I was doing some little bit of research, and there is a company called Zolli, it's Zolli, and it actually has more than 100 satellites orbiting the planet, and they are looking at things like AI satellite images to be able to develop this kind of data is what you're talking about. So I think a little bit more acknowledgement and presentation of here is what people are doing currently. And this is what we think of, and this is what our USP is. Because, you know, when Shantanu was also talking about funding, a step before that is what is your MVP, which is your minimal viable product? What is that idea on which people will sign up? Countries will agree to do that. And if there's like a space, you know, like if there's a panel which, you know, allows you to send things in space, why would they say yes? Why would like an Elon Musk be, yeah, this is great and I wanted to sign up? So I think those were some of the points that I'd like to mention. But overall, I think everybody presented really well. My last bit is when I do presentations, and I tend to do very data-driven and heavy presentations, always have someone who has absolutely no idea of what the topic is and present to that person and do something known as a sentiment analysis. So by sentiment analysis, because we are in a virtual world, I end up telling people, you know, within the presentation, give me like some emoji or whatever is available on Zoom or other platforms to let me know if I'm making what I'm saying is making sense. And just do like a quick check of the way you're constructing big problem statements as well. So one thing that came up to me was when you mentioned that the human trafficking is a profitable industry and it's $150 billion. So for me to use the word, you could have said, you could probably have rephrased the sentence better to say that it's estimated to be a $150 billion global business. And of course, it is making profit to the folks who are involved in something as horrible as human trafficking. But I thought that the sentence could have been constructed a little better. It just came up. But I think overall, this was awesome. And it's a lovely way to spend, like, you know, I'm like so charged up in my head about all of these young leaders, you know, hopefully doing something in space and other stuff. So great job, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
If I may still go on. So when we're given a problem to solve, we all tend to, you know, come up with some solutions. So now we've heard three problems, very, very large problems and their potential solutions. I don't know if all three of you did attend the other two presentations as well. So, you know, crutches to thinking are always, you know, that you either want to build a solution. Either you can quickly go to the market and buy a solution, you know, your arm hurts, you go buy Panadol. You don't invent the Panadol, or you don't invent the wheel that you saw. Or the third is you probably partner with someone. So I think in all the three problem statements that I saw, they were very good candidates by the problems themselves, and they were brave attempts, but they could have just also explored many more choices, many more solutions had they just passed it through the spectrum. Can I just partner with someone? So the first was, let me partner with Delhi government. Or why not just partner with Google instead of collecting your own data? Why try to do everything yourself? So I think this is something that at least my company tries to do also, that we're probably far too big and too bureaucratic and that we cannot do anything productive anymore. So therefore we just go around shopping for really smart people like you. So, or borrowing other people's ideas. So that's what I think. If we borrow from each other, we become a much better ecosystem of problem solvers. And another thing, the third team, I was thinking maybe you and the team too could have used your satellite to solve the carbon monitoring as well as the challenge of trafficking, human trafficking together. That is truly out of the box thinking. So you could have just come here and say, we're going to present together with team two and we'll just have one presentation. So I think that would have just, that would have really lifted the whole thing for me, you know? So why not think like that? So I'm just trying to give you an example of where you can already partner within your very small group over here. So there's always partnerships to be looked at. So if that's the penny to drop over here, is always look for who can help you. Don't go reinventing the wheel. And if you can maybe build a satellite for 300,000, I'll fly you to Munich tomorrow.
Nice. Thanks, Shantanu and Swati. I want to add my two bits to what Shantanu said. And it's been irking me for a while, but I think all of us at Ogly have to I think these problem statements that we gave each of these teams, they themselves need some working on, because at some level they're killing the creativity. We already told them, build a IoT system or use a space satellite. So I think we need to sit together and work around this. And Kamal, Anjali and I, and from the next group onwards, we have to give them something more open-ended, because that's what the expectation from the leaders is, that we expect them to solve problems by creative thinking and thinking something, like Shantanu said, either build on something through a partnership or maybe think of something brand new. So I think the problem statements have to be redefined.
Yeah.
Swati, you want to say something?
Yeah, I just want to quickly add, I echo what you're saying. I think before even arriving at a problem space statement, it would be good to have a hypothesis and stress test it. And then, you know, in consulting, we have these five whys. So like ask like five like whys at every level. And that's where you come up at a problem statement and don't give them solutions. Just let them figure out.
That's true. That's true. We're gonna...
I think abstraction laddering is what you're talking about in design thinking. So I could completely connect with what you're saying. But great job done, team three. You must understand and appreciate when you can invite this level of maturity of conversation with the panelists. It's a pat on the back to you and a special pat on the back to Apurva, because I know she was the youngest and got on the first question. So special pat on the back to you that time.
Apurva, very well. Yeah, Apurva, okay. I'd just like to add, it's good to have answers, but trust me, the ability to be able to say I do not have an answer to that is superb and
yes,
good. And you know, that's awesome that you stood your ground. So yes. You stood your ground, Rifa stood her ground. So that's equally appreciated and pat on the back for that. So with that, I'm going to completely take Shantanu's advice seriously. I'm going to completely borrow from what Jeff Bezos wrote in his last shareholder letter, which is that staving off death is a thing you have to work on. You know, adapting to your environment, adapting to your teams that you had to collaborate. These are children who've, or young leaders who've come across 13 different schools, did not know each other a month back. So it's a lot of collaboration activity that has gone into motion for you to come up to this quality of presentations. But the distinctiveness is what makes you endearing. So that's what he goes on to say, that originality and that distinctiveness that you all have, which is when you are being yourself, is what is valuable. So when we are going and back to the companies and saying, it'll be amazing that though these are high schoolers, you'll be amazed with what they are able to see, is what the whole panel is encouraging you to be. Just be yourself, but work hard at that. It takes a lot to be yourself because there's so much pressure to sort of conform to say, didn't I tell you the solution? No, no, you didn't. Let me just think about it completely differently, because that's what the advantage of this Generation Z is. Unlike my generation, we were more bonded together on social and economic demographics. You guys bond faster on technology across the globe. And that's why we call the Generation Z the dialoguers, the collaborators. So you have the world completely open to you. So before I wrap it up, Pooja, any last words that you'd like to add, or anybody from the participants? It'll be lovely to hear from you as well.
My last words, like in every other session that I tell the group, is use it, otherwise you'll lose it. So the skills that we've sort of uncovered and normalized and demystified together over the last month are all skills that are learnable skills. These are not something that you're born with. And the only thing that will get you to the next, move you forward, is practice and nothing more and nothing less. There are students who would say that I'm not creative enough, or I can't think critically, or numbers or mathematics is not my forte. But these are all learnable skills, and we worked on how to sort of let go of your mental blocks. And with that, I just quickly show you on the screens, especially for the participants, the leaders, the adults might know it already. It's about human behavior. You're at one on 1st of Jan 2021. And if you make no changes, you will remain at one. And if you make no changes for that 365 days of the year, you will remain there. And make no changes in terms of practicing new skills or learning new ways of doing the same thing. It may not be practicing a brand new skill. It might also be thinking of doing the same thing repeatedly that you've been doing in an entirely different way. But if you make a very tiny, small change, just a little bit more, 1% more for those 365 days repeatedly. And the keyword here is consistency. You will go ahead 37.8 times. You'll move ahead. And if you move backwards, you know, this is where you land. So this is from one of my favorite books called Atomic Habits by James Clear. And my invitation to all of you is to keep making those small changes every day and keep practicing, keep the consistency. If you think communication skills is something you struggle with, and we've discussed this earlier, then just pick up any random topic and just communicate. And public speaking is not a situation where you've got a stage and you've got 30 people listening to you. Even another person listening to you, two people listening to you, is an opportunity for you to hone your communication skills. What are we having for dinner tonight? Communicate that in a assertive or a interesting manner with your parents, and that could be a situation to practice your communication skills. So on that note, I wish you all the best. And as I said, it's been a great journey with all of you. And thanks, Anjali and Kamal, for the opportunity.
Thank you, Pooja. Any of our leaders want to say anything? Otherwise, we'll anyways be in touch with all of you.
Ma'am, thank you all for teaching us these great things which we never knew and we would never come across if you hadn't taught us. And thank you all the members and all the adults for giving us great feedback. And thank you. And the rest of the teams, Team 2 and Team 3, I really liked your presentation. And well done. Great job.
I would also like to thank everyone here. You all are like a parent type figure who are making us improve in every way by giving us more thinking. We are now feeling an upgraded version of ourselves with more confidence and with infinite learning that we have got from here. And especially thank you, Pooja ma'am, for having that much patience of handling this much teenage group, which was not even possible. Thank you, ma'am, very much.
Been my pleasure.
Thank everyone. And if someone asked me about what I liked about the Vital program, I would say everything. Be it Pooja ma'am's very innovative games to our team being given just 4 minutes to to draw on diamond stencils and create a story out of it. And even the concept of the 7 C's of communication, which honestly speaking, I couldn't have understood them practically and so easily as she explained it. And can you even imagine using an origami sheet for this concept? That's such an amazing idea. And and I remember in our last session, we played this game called Just a Minute, where we learned not to say or repeat things or pause for too long. So that to being given the topic spontaneously, so that was quite a challenge, but we all of us loved.